The next speaker is Stéphane Graham-Lengrand, and who is going to introduce the talk Solving Bit Vectors with the MCSAT, Explanation for Bits and Pieces. This is joint work with Dejan and Bruno Dutertre. Dejan Jovanović and Bruno Dutertre. Okay, so please.
My name is Stéphane Graham-Lengrand. I'm presenting the paper entitled Solving Bit Vectors with MCSAT, Explanations from Bits and Pieces. Here's a very brief overview of our contribution. MCSAT stands for Model Constructing Satisfiability. It is a scheme for SMT solving that's an alternative to DPLL of T. In order to apply the MCSAT scheme to a particular theory T, you need a form of interpolation mechanism for T. Designing an efficient mechanism for the full theory of bit vectors is difficult, so we do it for two fragments of the theory. The first fragment is equality with concatenation and extraction of bit vectors. The second fragment is a fragment of bit vector arithmetic. Outside these fragments, we use a less efficient but generic procedure. The approach is implemented in SRI's SMT solver YIKES, and we experimented it on the SMT lib benchmarks. Here's the plan of my presentation. I'm going to give you an overview of MCSAT, then describe what we did with the bit vector theory, then describe the result of our experimentation, and conclude. MCSAT was introduced by Jovanović et al., and it is inspired by multiple contributions, including conflict resolution and specific decision procedures for theories such as nonlinear arithmetic. It is tailored to theories with a standard model that is used for evaluating constraints, for instance, arithmetic. Indeed, evaluation is a key aspect of MCSAT, so that solving a satisfiability problem, i.e. a set of constraints on variables x1, x2, x3, xn, is literally finding values for variables x1, x2, x3, xn so that the constraints evaluate to true in the standard model. MCSAT offers a template for decision procedures, an integration of such procedures with Boolean reasoning, and new possibilities for combining theories. The template is a generalization of how conflict-driven closed learning, i.e. CDCL, works, which is the core calculus of SAT solvers. As in CDCL, MCSAT runs are an alternation of search phases and conflict analysis phases. So just like CDCL has a trail that assigns Boolean values to Boolean variables, MCSAT has a trail that assigns Boolean values to theory atoms, and these constitute theory constraints that have to be satisfied, and assigns model values to first order variables, such as assigning the value 3/4 to X. As in CDCL, MCSAT successively guesses assignments, and MCSAT maintains the invariant that no constraint evaluates to false according to the assignments. That means that in order to pick a value for variable y after having picked values for variables x1, x2, x3, xn, you only have to worry about those constraints over variables x1, x2, x3, xn, and y in order to satisfy the invariant. Those constraints, we call them unit in y. Now, if all variables get values while this invariant is maintained, then your initial problem is satisfiable. We illustrate this scenario on the next slide. On this slide, on the right-hand side here, I've got the variables of the problem that I ordered according to the decisions that we make. Once you have this ordering, you can organize the constraints that you have to satisfy into layers. The first layers is made of all of those constraints that only concern x1. The second layer is made of constraints that concern x1 and x2. The third layer is made of constraints that concern x1, x2, x3, etc., etc. Now, those constraints that only concern x1 are all units in x1. And as such, they immediately restrict the set of feasible values that you can assign to x1. So in this column here, I have represented the set of all values, and the green fragment is the subset of feasible values that you can assign to x1 without violating one of your unit constraints. Now, once you have that, you can pick a value for x1, and by doing so, you make other constraints in the next layers unit in their respective variables. That has an effect of restricting further the set of feasible values for those variables. So you continue by picking a value for x2, this further restricts the set of feasible values for the next variables. You continue with x3, etc., etc. And if you're lucky, you manage to assign a value to all variables and you can answer SAT to your original problem. But what will happen in many cases is that you start assigning values to x1, to x2, to x3, and the successive restrictions on the sets of feasible values are such that for one of the variables, the set of feasible values ends up being empty. So you cannot pick a value for xi in this example, and that means that you have a conflict. A conflict is a situation in which this invariant I was talking about cannot be maintained. That means that some variables x1, x2, x3, xn have already been assigned values, and here n is I minus 1, and this constitutes a partial model M. Moreover, no value can be assigned to the variable y, which is here xi, to extend model M into a model of the constraints c1, c2, c3, cm that are unit in y. In other words, the model M falsifies the formula that exists of y such that c1 and c2 and c3 and cm. And I'm going to use the abbreviation that exists to y such that a for that formula. Now, what you do in that situation is that you have to backtrack and try other values for x1, x2, x3, xn. In other words, try another model M prime. But you want to avoid picking the same values, i.e. the same model M, or you even want to avoid picking another model M prime that would fail for the same reason that M failed. In order to do that, we generalize the model M into a class of failing models that we characterize with a conflict explanation. In order to illustrate the notion of conflict explanation, I've drawn a little diagram here on the right. We've got three variables, x1, x2, and y. The constraints over those three variables are grouped into the formula A, and this blue shape here represents those triples of values for x1, x2, y that satisfy A. Beneath A, there's a gray shape here which lives in the space of values for x1 and x2, and it's the projection of A, i.e. the models for x1, x2 that satisfy there exists a y such that A. Unfortunately, the model that we've picked so far for x1, x2 is not in this gray shape, meaning that we cannot find a value for y that satisfy A. So what we do in that situation is that we're going to produce a conflict explanation that explains why M is outside of this gray area. It takes the shape of a quantifier-free formula B, whose free variables in that case are x1 and x2, that's over-approximating the gray shape that exists of y such that A. That means that according to the theory, there exists a y such that A implies B, and M is still B is still not satisfied by M. In other words, B is an interpolant of there exists a y such that A at model M. Graphically, it means that we have separated the space of values for x1, x2 into those models satisfying B and that may have a chance of satisfying there exists a y such that A, and those models like M that do not satisfy this formula B and have no chance of satisfying the formula that exists of y such that A. Once we have produced this interpolant B, MCSAT considers the theory lemma A implies B that rules out not only model M, but a set of similar models. We impose that B be a clause so that A implies B is a clause. If some of the constraints in the conflict result from Boolean propagation, then we're going to perform Boolean conflict analysis on those constraints using Boolean resolution. MCSAT will backtrack to a point where A implies B is no longer violated, for instance, if B no longer evaluates to false. All right, so once you have a theory T and you want to turn it into a plugin for MCSAT, you need two ingredients. The first ingredient is an efficient way of representing domains of feasible values and how they are affected by unit constraints. The second ingredient is an explanation mechanism that's going to produce interpolants as clauses. There are some conditions to ensure termination, but I'm going to skip over them in this talk. The MCSAT framework is implemented in Yikes, which is SRI's main SMT solver, and it has plugins for Boolean for Boolean logic, nonlinear arithmetic, equality with uninterpreted function symbols, all of which can be mixed, and now it has a plugin for bit vectors. All right, so the traditional approach for solving bit vector problems is to encode bit vectors and bit vector problems into Boolean logic. You can have one Boolean variable for each bit of each bit vector variable, and then call a SAT solver on the resulting Boolean formula. This is called bit blasting. In this paper, we turn the bit vector theory into a plugin for MCSAT. Now, just to jump a little bit to the conclusion, on the whole, SMTD bit vector benchmarks, MCSAT does not perform as well as long-established bit blasting solvers. I'm going to give you the comparison later. But there's a decent subset of instances where it does perform better. For instance, in this example, we are trying to prove that if x is strictly smaller than y, then x plus 1 is smaller than or equal to y. Now, if you consider this theorem where x and y have a huge bit width, like almost 30,000, then the best two SMT solvers from the SMT comp 2019 cannot solve this, and they both use bit blasting. MCSAT can solve this. All right, so in order to turn the theory of bit vectors into a plugin for MCSAT, we need first a nice way of representing domains of feasible values. For this, we use binary decision diagrams, BDDs, that encode functions from n bits to 1 bit. And you can consider BDDs over the bits of an n-bit bit vector variable y. And one BDD will represent a set of bit vector values for y. Updating the set of feasible values as soon as a constraint becomes unit in y corresponds to computing the conjunction of two BDDs. The second ingredient that we need is an explanation mechanism that produces closure interpolants. Now, the conditions for termination here are easily satisfied because the bit vector theory is finite. So we have a formula that exists to y such that C1, C2, C3, Cm. It evaluates to force in the current model, and we want to explain why. So there's a naive explanation mechanism which consists in first taking the description of the model, x1 equals the value v1, x2 equals the value v2, etc., and take the negation of this as the interpolant. Now, this interpolant is sound, but it only rules out model M. A better explanation mechanism would be to consider the following formula, which is the conjunction of all of these unit constraints in Y and the description of the model. Now, you take this formula, you bit blast it, you turn it into a Boolean problem, and you submit it to a SAT solver. Now, you already know that the answer is unsat, otherwise you wouldn't be in a conflict. But what's important is that the SAT solver is going to give you back an unsat core that's going to identify the bits of x1, x2, x3, xn that mattered for that conflict. Now, this is better than the naive mechanism, but it's still inefficient. For instance, many bit-level explanations may be needed in order to capture a property that could be simply expressed at the word level. So what we really want is a way of producing explanations at the word level. The difficulty of doing this is the diversity of word-level bit vector operations. So in this paper, we identify two fragments of the bit vector theory for which we design nice explanation mechanisms. So what we're going to do in order to produce an interpolant at model M is to first get a conflict core that's going to remove redundant constraints. Among the constraints that are unit in Y, C1, C2, C3, Cm, there may be some redundancy, so you want to remove those constraints that are redundant. We use the quick explain mechanism, the quick explain algorithm on BDDs in order to perform this. Now, for those constraints that remain, we aggressively rewrite them in the hope that they fit into one of these two fragments. If they do not fit into one of these two fragments, then we use bit blasting with an unsat core in order to produce an explanation. The two fragments are equality with concatenation and extraction, and a fragment of linear bit vector arithmetic. I'm not going to say too much about equality with concat and extract. Here's just the little grammar that describes the fragment. We have equalities, disequalities, any kind of extraction on the conflict variable y, any kind of concatenation, and any term e that's evaluable in the sense that it does not feature the conflict variable y. In other words, all of the free variables of e have been assigned values in the model M, and therefore e can be evaluated as a value. Now, the explanation mechanism that we give in the paper uses slicing and a notion of e-graph that's aware of the model M. The second fragment is for bit vector arithmetic, and I'm going to start with a concrete example. Here we have a model M assigning values to three variables x1, x2, x3, and we've got three constraints c1, c2, c3. In this diagram here, I've represented the full domain of values for bit vectors on 4 bits, so z over 2^4 z. And what we're going to do is to convert those constraints into intervals of forbidden values. So for instance, the first constraint C1 says that y should be different from x1. So we can produce an interval I1, which is from x1 to x1 plus 1. The upper bound is excluded and the lower bound is included. And the values in that interval are ruled out. So the constraint C1 rules out a chunk of the model, a chunk of the domain here. We do the same for constraint C2. We produce an interval of forbidden values for C2, and it rules out another chunk. We do the same for C3, and it rules out the last remaining chunk of the domain. Now, with those three constraints, in model M, we cannot find a value for Y because those three intervals cover the whole domain. So the explanation for why we can't find a value for Y is that the union of those three intervals is the full domain. In other words, the upper bound of interval I1 belongs to I3, the upper bound of interval I3 belongs to I2, and the upper bound of interval I2 belongs to I1. More generally, if you have a bit width W, you do the same thing. You convert every constraint CI into an interval II with an upper bound UI. You compute the intervals that are ruled out by each constraint, and these may overlap. That was perfectly fine. And once you've done that, you realize that all values have been forbidden because the union of all the intervals cover the whole domain. So in the model M, the upper bound of one interval belongs to the next interval, whose upper bound belongs to the next interval, whose upper bound belongs to the next interval, until all the circle is closed. What happens in the model can be generalized into a formula. U1 belongs to I2, and U2 belongs to I4, and U4 belongs to I3, and U3 belongs to I1. All right. So what you need to do in practice is, as I said, convert each constraint CI into a forbidden interval II. There are exactly 12 cases to consider, and they are listed in table 1 in the paper. Now, once you have the intervals, what you need to do is to extract a sequence of those intervals that cover the whole circle in model M, meaning that two consecutive intervals are hooked together. Okay, so the upper bound of one interval belongs to the next interval. In the example that we had, the sequence is I1, I3, I2. And finally, you have to express those constraints. A belongs to interval DU in the language of linear bit vector arithmetic. In that case, we can express this as A minus D is strictly smaller, unsigned smaller, than U minus D. So in the example, we had this explanation here, okay, which can easily be converted into this formula in the language of bit vector arithmetic. All right. Now, those 12 cases I was talking about, they cover the following grammar. Okay, constraints are atoms or negation of atoms, and atoms are large inequalities, unsigned, where the conflict variable y can appear on both sides of the inequality, on the right-hand side of the inequality, or on the left-hand side of the inequality. Now here, E1 and E2 also range over the evaluable terms. The first way of extending this is to not just have y in those inequalities, but any lower bit extract of y. Okay, so here this notation means the bits from 0 to h. Now, h here can be different in the various inequalities that you have. So in order to handle this, you need to convert those constraints into intervals, but those intervals concern different bit widths, meaning that here, for instance, you have the domain for the lowest 4 bits of y. Here you have the domain for the lowest 2 bits of y, and here you have the domain for the lowest bit of y, and each constraint is going to rule out one particular chunk of one particular domain. Now, when you look at this, it's not completely obvious that with all of these constraints, you cannot find a value for y that satisfies the constraint. But the algorithm that we have in the paper does this. The second generalization is simply to extend the grammar for terms with upper bit extraction. That means all of the bits from L to the greatest bit of t, addition of a variable terms, negation, concatenation with zero on the left and on the right. In order to handle that extension of the grammar, we simply need an algorithm that's going to reduce the constraint in this extended grammar into a constraint in the smaller grammar. All right. The completely different way of extending the scope of our conflict explanation mechanisms is to perform pre-processing every time we hit a conflict. So we have a bunch of rules, of rewrite rules, that we apply eagerly as soon as we have a conflict and we've extracted a core from it. I'm not going to go through the rules, but basically with those rules, we can handle a bigger grammar here with any extraction of a term, with concatenation with variable terms on the left, on the right, with sign extensions, and the predicate symbol that we have in the atoms is any of those predicate symbols that you have in the vector theory. Right, so I'm going to present the result of our experimentation on the SMT benchmarks. So we've tested our solver on the on a bit more than 41,000 instances that we found in the SMT lib in the quantifier-free bit vector category. We've run our solver with a timeout of 3 minutes, and it produced the following graph. So the x-axis here is the number of benchmarks solved. The y-axis here is the time that it took. So the top value here is 180 seconds, which is 3 minutes. And we've got various curves here, which represent different configurations for our solver. So the right curve here is our baseline, which is using the explanation mechanism provided by default through bit blasting and unsat calls. Now, this is our baseline. If you add to it our explanation mechanism for the fragment with equality and concatenation and extraction, you have the yellow line here. If you add to the baseline our explanation mechanism for bit vector arithmetic, we have the brown curve here, which is better. And if you add to the baseline both explanation mechanisms, then you have the blue line here, which is the best of all curves. We've added here the performance that we had at the last SMT competition in 2019. And we have a final curve here, the orange one, which is basically the same as the blue one, except that we've turned off one of the features that we also implemented in IJCAR, which is the bit vector value propagation mechanism. So basically, every time we detect that the domain of feasible values for a variable is a singleton, then we immediately eagerly propagate that this variable should get the last remaining value on the train. And if we turn that off, then it decreases the performance. All right, in terms of numbers, our solver solves a bit more than 33,000 instances. And interestingly enough, more than 14,000 are actually solved by pure pre-processing, even before we invoke the MCSAT solver. Another 19,000 are solved by MCSAT itself. Out of those 19,000, interestingly enough, 14,000, a bit more than 14,000 are solved without ever calling the default bit blasting baseline. Okay, so just they just rely on those two dedicated explanation mechanisms that we have. Roughly half of the benchmarks in the category entirely fit within the two fragments that we have described. And then a bit less than 5,000 are solved by a combination of our three experiments. Now, we have compared our solver with two solvers that are based on bit blasting. These are the best two solvers from the SMT comp 2019, IJCAR plus Calico and Boolean plus Calico. They both solve almost 41,000. So MCSAT is not as good as them on the whole, but in the paper, we identify classes of instances where MCSAT is better. In particular, our arithmetic explanation mechanism is rather insensitive to big bit widths. And MCSAT could solve almost 800 instances for which Boolean with Calico timed out in 3 minutes. All right. to conclude, I'm going to mention some related work. The application of MCSAT to the bit vector theory was first explored by Sedgwick et al. Using bit vector intervals and masks to represent domains instead of BDDs, and using eager propagation mechanisms instead of using interpolation like we did. And our numbers on the SMTlib seem to improve on this quite a bit. Our work also extends preliminary work that we presented at the SMT workshop, and the main improvements that we have compared to then is the use of arbitrary evaluable terms to extend the scopes of the two fragments, the generalization and number two of the arithmetic explanation mechanism, the normalization of conflicts by rewrite rules, and the experimentation. What we want to do in the future is to extend the two fragments little by little. In particular, we want to handle a bigger fragment of bit vector arithmetic where the conflict variable y can have an arbitrary coefficient in the polynomials of the constraint. We also want to explore whether some techniques that are used for quantified bit vector solving can help MCSAT, for instance, the invertibility conditions of Nimet et al., as well as other techniques that are inspired by quantifier elimination. Finally, even if MCSAT ends up not performing as well as bit blasting on ground instances, it may still be interesting to produce word-level explanations of conflicts, and we're currently investigating two applications of this. The first application is a general interpolation problem for the bit vector theory, and the second application is solving quantified problems in the bit vector theory. And I'm ready to answer your questions. Thank you.
Okay. Again, we thank our speaker and this time for a few questions. Please book, raise your virtual hand, please. Okay, in the meantime, seems that people are quite shy, so I'm going to ask one. You mentioned one of the two fragments that you mentioned during your presentation is the arithmetic fragment, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But with this pure arithmetic fragment, couldn't you also compare against the encoding into modular arithmetic, integer arithmetic? I mean, the problem, so you know there's been a lot of work on encoding bivector in integer, in modular integer arithmetic. And the problem with that is that it works well when you are doing arithmetic, but then it works badly when you have say, bitwise operators or whatever else. Would it make sense to compare against that with against that fragment?
Yes, definitely.
Which doesn't work well in general, but it may work well in that fragment.
That's something that we haven't done yet, but I think it's a great idea. One difference that I may expect is that, so I assume that when you encode into modular arithmetic, you're trying to encode the whole problem. In MCSAT, the explanation mechanism that we use is a mechanism that we use at each conflict. So MCSAT may be able to integrate a little bit more than arithmetic, and it's just that per conflict, if you're lucky enough that the conflict lies within the fragment, then you have this nice explanation mechanism. But if you have something in your whole problem that is not really an arithmetic operation, then it's not really an issue. I mean, it doesn't kill the whole approach. I would say that we hope that each conflict is in this fragment. If some parts of the whole problem aren't, it may still work. Whereas if you encode into modular arithmetic, I assume that you hope that the whole problem fits into that fragment.
There seems to be a question typed by Armin Beer. He says, he asks, I read it, what other example work with your approach besides those with the big bit widths, for which you also have this big bit blasting to model check approx from SMT 13?
Yeah, so we have the, for instance, another class is where it performs rather well is the Brutto Meso benchmarks on involving equality, concatenation, extraction, and the slicing mechanism. Apart from this, it's some subsets of the QFBV category of the SMTlib. I don't have a general rule of thumb about how to characterize those subsets of the category where it works well. We should definitely. I see the reference there to the paper in SMT 2013 that we should definitely look at and compare with.
Okay, so I think we are 5 minutes late in our schedule, and I don't see any other bookings. So I think we can. Thank you for speaking again, as in I clap on behalf of all the